So did you watch BTE and the what's it called? The waiting room segment?
I did not. I literally finished the show right before I called you.
Oh, geez. You missed everything then. I mean, there was nothing today that you know, is even close to that stuff. The BTE was the best show probably overall. That it may have been the best one they've ever done, but it's the best one in a long, long time. I mean, I don't even want to recap it because it's just 30 minutes of consecutive laughing. I just laughed and laughed and laughed at everything. All their comedy hit. It was, the stars were, you know, I mean, there were so many stars, but Frankie Kazarian, who's the guy. Frankie Kazarian is the guy this week. There's nobody close to Frankie Kazarian. Between the promo that he did on Dark and his performance throughout the entire BTE, it was just incredible. So the Dark thing, which was actually probably the biggest thing, was with him and Christopher Daniels, and they were on the Britt Baker waiting room segment. So anything I say cannot do this justice. I would just tell everyone that this, you know, you don't need to watch all of Dark. I mean, there's some good stuff there, but this segment you have to watch because it's one of the best segments on wrestling all year. And the gist of it was that he came out and he starts talking about you know, that the year sucked. It's been a terrible year. And the one thing he could always count on was Christopher Daniels. Christopher Daniels is his best friend. But when in the match with the Acclaimed last week, you know, Christopher Daniels lost. And he said, like, whenever we team up and we lose, it's always Christopher Daniels who loses. And he just starts, you know, basically saying that, you know, he loves wrestling, and he's all conflicted because Christopher Daniels is his best friend in the whole world, but you know, he keeps losing key matches, and so it's like your personal and professional, it's kind of getting in the way. And then Christopher Daniels goes, yeah, this has been a terrible year, and I've lost something. And you know, it basically was like, I've been getting anxiety whenever I go to the ring, and I, you know, worry. And then I, you know, he's going through all this, and basically said that I never want to tarnish my legacy. So, you know, I always told myself that when it got like this, then it's time to retire. So he basically was going to retire. And then Kazarian goes, you can't do that. And Kazarian basically reverses and goes, you can't do that. And then he goes through this whole speech about how much he loves wrestling. You know, wrestling has given me a life I never dreamed I'd be able to get. I met my wife through wrestling. I have an 8-year-old son because of wrestling. The roof over his head was paid for by wrestling. Every single meal my son has eaten has been paid for by wrestling. And he starts with, you know, Chris, you know, you don't get to retire that easy. You're not going out like this. So they basically set up a storyline, which is identical to the Ric Flair storyline in WWE about a dozen years ago, that got completely botched, which was all Steve Austin's idea, by the way. And Steve Austin, like, laid out, I remember what you know, Vince wanted to retire Ric Flair. Ric Flair didn't want to retire, but Vince wanted to retire Ric Flair, and somehow or other he talked to Steve Austin. Steve Austin came up with a scenario that do a thing where Ric Flair has to retire in his next loss, and then Ric Flair goes on a winning streak and beats everybody. And, you know, I remember being told the angle, and I thought, well, that'd be so cool if, you know, he goes in there and I think the idea was for Sean to beat him, and I think Rick wanted that, to be Sean. But I always thought that, like, maybe, I think Randy Orton was the champion at the time, and I thought maybe do something where he either beats Randy Orton and loses to Sean, or he loses to Randy Orton in a title match, and that's how he goes out. And then they started doing DQs and everything, and it just lost its momentum. And it was the easiest thing in the world to book. And it was absolutely, by the time they got to the end, even though the Flair Shawn thing was pretty emotional and people remember it very well, I just thought the whole angle was, you know, completely botched. You know, it's the same thing. So Daniels and Kazarian are going to be wrestling. They're going to start with Evans and Angelico. And the next time that they lose a match, they will never team up again. And I don't know if Chris will retire, but that's the implication, certainly, is that then he will retire. So it looks to me like they're going to do a program where they start beating everybody and then ends up with a big match with the Young Bucks. I don't know if that's going to be at the next pay-per-view or what, but and I don't even know that that's necessarily where they're going. It's just me watching it going, this is where they should be going. So if they end up not going there, I'll just say the same thing I just said about the Flair thing, that it could have been done better. So anyway, that's Dark. So as far as BTE goes, you know, because it was, the whole thing was Frankie Kazarian's the guy in you know, Christmas Carol or whatever, one of the thing where he's the ghost from Christmas past and the ghost from Christmas present and the whole bit. You know, they did like a whole bunch of skits with him, which were always related to all of the mean things he's done all year to Brandon Cutler and calling him a mark all year and going through all these skits, and including and it was Christopher Daniels, who was like being a ghost, and Trent Barretta's being a ghost, and Chuck Taylor's being a ghost. And one of the things they did was they also had a new clip of Kazarian. He's at the bar and he's drinking and there's nobody there, and then all of a sudden Brandon Cutler shows up and he's been hiding behind the bar and he's looking at all these like you know, hot, these different sauces in the bar, and he's looking at these sauces, and this segment was so hilarious. So he's looking at these sauces, and he's going to Kazarian, and he's going like, yeah, the guys are telling me, you know, like, you know, to get really jacked, I need to get on the sauce. So he had like hot sauce and all these. So I'm just wondering, like, what sauces should I be putting on my chicken, you know, to get all jacked? And Kazarian's just going like, you idiot, you mark. And he starts talking about like, yeah, like the next thing you know, like what you think, did anyone tell you to go on the gas? And he goes, yeah, I was going to go to Shell and get on the gas, but I didn't know what exactly which kind of gas. They never told me. And so they're going through all this, and Kazarian's talking about, do you know anything? Do you know? I start talking about Dr. Zahorian, right? And it's just like, and while he's doing, and Brandon Cutler's like, knows nothing, right? Because I've never heard of any of this. And he's just calling him like a mark and everything like that. And so that was like another segment, and then it ends up where it ends up the way it ends up, but it's absolutely tremendous. And then the Dark Order was doing Christmas carols and all dressed up in Christmas stuff, except for Colt Cabana, who is wearing like an I Love Hanukkah t-shirt. And by like the end of the thing, like Colt Cabana was the Christmas expert that they were going to for all the advice, and he's talking about like the 8 days of Christmas and all this. And it ends up you know, where Frankie Kazarian goes into the bathroom, and they're all, the Dark Order, including Anna Jay, are all in the stall, and they're singing Christmas carols to him. And it ends up where they're singing these like Christmas carols, and then finally at the end, they got Adam Page in the party room, and they sing this song, you know, Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, basically, except it's called Adam the Handsome Cowboy, and they're trying to recruit him. And it's just, it's one of those things where, you know, like, you know, on that show, you know, some of the comedy works and some of it doesn't. It's a hit and miss show. Some weeks are better than the other. But this was 30 minutes and every bit hit. It was the best wrestling show on television or on streaming or anything in a long, long time. And but the best segment was still the Kazarian and Daniel segment on Dark was still the best segment that probably has been on any show I couldn't even tell you how long. I mean, it was just, those two guys were super. So that's the stuff that we should be talking about. That was the best stuff. It was nothing knocking today's TV, but nothing on today's TV was in the league of any of that stuff. So
I'm glad that cheered you up.
Yeah, I'm sure I've left out like a lot of good stuff. They did a card game. That wasn't necessarily, I mean, that was fine. You know, just because everybody, just the way they were doing the card game, an elimination card game, and everybody was like, losing their stuff and everything. And then Matt Hardy, I'm going to go through this whole thing. I didn't even talk. Matt Hardy did one of the best. He did the best promo since he's been in AEW. They were basically, the Young Bucks came up to him. Well, first, he's with Private Party, and he's explaining, what he's been doing, and he's trying to toughen them up and all this. And then Matt and Nick Jackson come up to him, and they basically say, you've been a prick. And then he gives this promo about how he came to AEW, and Matt and Nick brought him to AEW, and he was, he came in and he did this character, and then he got the match at All Out, and he just goes like, people were going like, we don't want you on TV, you're too old, we want to see the young guys. And he said, I'm going to go to All Out and I'm going to give these people this incredible match, which is the match with Sammy Guevara. And then he got hurt in the match, and he said that, like, but I wasn't hurt that bad, but he said, I got hurt, and then all I heard is that it was my fault, and that I'm old, and I'm this, and I'm that, and I just got tired of it. And it's like, all of these, my whole career, all I've done is done stuff for other people. He goes, I for all these years, I tried to help my brother. I tried to help the young guys. I tried to help, my family by doing the Broken Matt skit where, all the family got involved. He goes, and now I'm just trying to do something for me. And that's why I'm doing this, because I'm trying to remind people that like, I've been in this, that I'm who I am, and I'm finally doing something just for myself rather than for the business. So he did that promo much better than I did, by far. But that actually was, that was his best promo since he's been there. And there was nothing on any of these shows either this week, on any show, promo-wise, that touched that. So that's the best stuff, is, BTE and the segment on AEW Dark.
Hey, if you're a big fan of Wrestling Observer Radio, we got 12,000 episodes of all of our podcasts up at our website, WrestlingObserver.com. If you sign up today, you get access to every single one of them. The 12 to 18 new shows that we do every single week. You can podcast them, listen to them on the road, at work, working out, in the shower, wherever you listen to your podcasts. And also full access to the Wrestling Observer newsletter and archives. So if you love what you hear, head to WrestlingObserver.com. 12,000 audio shows at your fingertips.